Thank you very much for that, Professor Chan. I think a couple of things that particularly struck me about the work you presented there was the importance of timely feedback, and I think that's particularly important. That you say the horse is bolted if I get feedback 2 months after I've done the assessment task and I've already engaged in the subsequent assessment task. And the notion around the authenticity of the task that you're looking at, I think, is particularly important as well. So our third speaker is the Faculty of Science, Technology, Environment, Faculty Teaching Excellence Award winner, and of course our BC's Award winner, Professor Sushil Kumar. Professor Kumar.
Good afternoon. I come from science physics. The teaching and learning strategies in sciences, for example, in physics, they are all around the experimentation, the applications of the fundamental principles to the real life problems, the scientific investigation, and then finding out a particular pattern. For that, we require our students to be the critical thinker and then the problem solver at the end. I repeat the word as the problem solver and critical thinker. In my presentation, I would first of all like to present a bit of my teaching strategies which are suitable for my subject, the physics, and then I will come the type of assessments I use and then the feedbacks I give to my students. The technical terms, before I come to the technical terms, a little bit about me. I am right now involved with the four or five courses at UG and at the PG level. I am here from last 15 years. The technical terms, I think my colleagues have already presented. I would like to draw your attention that there is a flexible learning policy in view of USP's regional and distributed nature. You can read all those, the technical terms and so on, which are applied to the USP. The flexible learning environment, and then the most important for me is the independent learning. For that, I need my students to be critical thinker and then the problem solver. Okay. Well, let me repeat the word again, the independent learners. Okay. There is a cycle. I was looking in the literature, and I think that's a cycle from my point of view, I find very suitable for my students to follow, starting from I give a very loosely structured problem or a question to my student. And then the students then consolidate that and go through the cycle and then finally come to a solution. If I compare this independent learning cycle, I find that it is very consistent with the research skills development framework which the USP is using, starting from the embark and clarify to finally coming to analyze and synthesis and then to communicate and apply. Okay. Well, before we go to our class, it's very important that we must know what is the international trend of the students and what kind of students I have got in my class. Okay. In that, I think we are very lucky that the students from South Pacific region, they are very, very disciplined and they want to solve the problems and so on, but at times there are little bit problems that they sometimes students do cut and paste from here and there, okay? All right, so what is effective teaching strategies, okay? Well, I like the Chinese proverb which says that the thousand teachers, the thousand methods, and then you have to think critically what method or a strategy will be more applicable to me. I believe in a well-managed class, very important. Okay. The well-managed class is supposed to have few things like this, a very positive environment, a little bit humorous environment. If it is not there, at times you might have to create it. And I think even a good discipline also plays a very positive role in the learning. I give you a little example of a little bit humor creating in a class. One day I was teaching and I saw that my students are looking very, very low. They very little enthusiasm them in the motivation. And in the physics, I said, well, guys, you open your notebook, I'm going to give you a quiz question. And then I said, well, the student took their notes out and then started writing. And I said, well, look at, a train is moving from east to west with 20 kilometers per hour. Oh, they jotted down. And then the another train, B, is moving from west to east with 40 kilometers per hour. Calculate my age. Okay? So then the students started doing something, adding 20 plus 10, dividing and so on and so on. And then I didn't get the answer. So the one of the students who were very smart, he said that, sir, your age is 42 years. And I said, well, yes, my age is 42 years. How do you know it? He said, sir, my cousin brother is half idiot and his age is 21 years. Therefore, your age is 42 years. Little bit. So some of the students didn't catch up. They were thinking, and then some of them could do the calculation and so on. All right. So my strategy is the mixed method. Okay? I have come from, as a student, I have developed as a very traditional student, traditional teachers, where the teachers will draw the diagram one by one, and then on the right side will solve the problem step by step. And I think for some of the subjects like mathematics, physics, and so on, at times that approach is very useful. And I use it. All what I do is that I add the technological component in that. Rather than going there, drawing each and every diagram, I do a little simulation, bring part by part, and then solve it here. Okay. And then I use the multimedia and so on, wherever they are required, so that my approach is the mixed one here, the traditional as well as the technological enhanced. And then these are my normal approaches. I start from Z to A approach. That is quite useful, is that traditionally I will pick up a topic and then do the derivation and then solve the problems, then tell the application. So when I tell the application, that's the time students start thinking, well, this topic was important and having the applications too. In Z to A approach, what we do is we first of all explain the importance and then the applications of the topic. And then we come to theory and so on. The next one is the problem-based, which is very important for the science-based subject, particularly for the physics. I give them the problem, and the students do think how to find out solution. And for the research-active universities, for example, like USP nowadays, I think a research-based technology teaching approach is very, very useful, and then all those. Let me give you an example of each one of them. For example, for Z2A approach, okay, is something where I explain the application first. An experiment, okay, which was done by Galileo Galilei 400 years back. Okay, before that, the concept was that the heavier objects will fall faster than the lighter one. Okay, so how many of you know that the objectives, irrespective of the mass, forgetting the air resistance, will fall with a constant speed, they fall constantly. So before that, the concept was that the heavier objects will fall faster. And this guy did an experiment. He, from a tower, he dropped the two objects of different masses and observed the position of those like this at time t is equal to zero, the heavier one and lighter one, and slowly. And what he found that means until the time these objects hit the ground, they were moving simultaneously. And this is where then we explain and where we prove the hypothesis that the objects fall constantly irrespective of the mass. And I think that was one of the great discovery starting from the applications. Okay. The next one is the problem based. I give an example of the buildings. You might have seen that over the temples, churches, and then the big government buildings, there is something called lightning conductor. Okay, why it is so? Actually, it is to protect the buildings from lightnings. So I give a problem that, well, there is a threat to the buildings from the lightnings, and then how can we solve it? Okay. So then the students, earlier I used to teach them, well, we can put a lightning conductor, and then that's how the conductor works and so on. And then I was attending a conference, this one here, and one of my colleagues in 2014 made a good presentation of real-time lightning recording. Okay. And then I thought, well, this is what I think I can, if I can borrow from my colleague, this is what I can use for my teaching. And then I'm using it. This is what explains that during the lightning, how does it happen? It's a real-time recording. Here, like this. This return current. So I give this example and then explain them the amount of voltage and current is associated with the lightnings, and then what kind of threat they pose, and then how we can protect the buildings and so on. Okay. So in that term, if I explain about the lightnings and then it is severity, I think that generates interest in the class. Okay. A research-based example means it is for one of my course, means I have got an experiment where the students look at the real-time recording of strong lightnings. The dots here are the real-time lightnings happening. And then the students do record it during the normal conditions, daytime and nighttime, during tropical cyclones and so on. And then they look at how the things or the atmosphere changes during the severe weather conditions and so on. Okay. Well, before I come to my assessment and feedback, I draw your attention to the golden triangle in the literature, is that the learning outcomes have to be consistent with the assessment, okay? And then they have to come from the teaching and learning activities. Our learning outcomes have to be SMART. You all know that what the SMART means. There's a lot of emphasis in the USP. They must be measurable, and they must build on the Bloom's taxonomy. Okay. That means the level of complexity or the skills you require to solve the problem, it increases as you move from lower level to the higher level. Okay. Well, I'd like to draw your attention over this document about the assessment. If you have not, I think I have received it from PVC's one of the presentation. I'm not explaining this, but I was to just draw your attention. This is what has been is driving the assessment nowadays. Okay. The assessment I use is of three types, actually, primarily. It is already given in the literature. And why I use it is here. For diagnostic assessment, I use to know what my students need to learn. And similarly, for formative, for what I need, and then the summative to judge the performance at the end. Okay. So the diagnostic assessments, the aim is here. Why do we need that one? Is to know the strength and weakness. And some of the examples, what I use is the interviews here, and then the questioning, and then the observations. Okay, I don't use it much. I use it primarily, this one, when a new research student joins me. I will call the students two times in a week. And then related to the project, I will try to find out what kind of skills the students need, what kind of knowledge the student need, and what he has got. So I worked out from this, and then I give my feedback. Well, you go to that document, you go to that resource, and then update yourself, okay? Then comes the formative assessment. Here. We know that the formative assessment actually is for learning. And then to give the feedback so that they can improve upon the assessment here. The assessments, the type of assessments could be here, like informal observations. I do it in my lab. I do observe that how the students are performing, and then look at means what kind of motivation, enthusiasm they have, and accordingly I advise. I give sometimes the quizzes here, and then give the feedback, and they improve upon. And then the questioning to the students, and at times having the discussion, okay? By definition, the formative assessment cannot be used for grading here, all right? But we are using a bit of the mixed approach. We give them the assessment, we grade that, and we give the feedback also, okay? Then comes the summative assessment. This is where we test the overall performance of the students. In the summative assessments, I give them the tests, two tests. I give my courses have got the laboratory component, they have got the projects, they have got the field trips, and then the examination. Okay. For my test, I use the Bloom taxonomy for designing the learning outcomes, but the lower level, because the time is very limited there, 30 minutes, 45 minutes. And then when it comes to examination, this is where I use all the levels of Bloom taxonomy for determining the questions and so on. Okay. And that's how the students do rise, starting from diagnostic assessment, then the formative assessment, and then finally they reach to the summative assessment here. Okay. Now I move to the feedback, all right? I was looking at literature. Primarily the literature which was given to me by PVC, a full thesis actually. And then I found that the idea of the feedback, it came from the electronics and physics. We do teach a topic called amplifiers, which amplify the weak signal to the larger signal. And I can add little bit more circuit in that and can make it a feedback amplifier. So if I give a positive feedback, then the output is enhanced. Very simple. So if my feedback to the students is positive, the students' learning will improve. And if I give a negative feedback here in the amplifier, then the amplifier's output is decreased. Okay. So the same concept is applied for the students' feedback as well. Okay. Well, the feedbacks, if you look at into the literature, there are different kind of feedbacks. Okay. And then the feedback particularly I use is the formative. At times, this feedback is also very useful. Acknowledgement, some of the students, after submitting the assignment, they might inquire you, okay? We can see that, well, on the Moodle assignment is there, why there's no point of wasting the time to write to students, but they get worried. And then it's good always to acknowledge those things a little bit. In case you want to read a bit more about the feedback, please do read this PhD thesis, actually. This is what briefly I have gone through. All right. And then the feedback I use, actually. The feedback I use is the constructive, where I try to identify the strength and weakness, and then explain to the students timely. It's very important, right? Everyone is talking. The timely feedback is very important because the students are doing one assignment, then for another course, and for your course, the another one. And if you don't give the timely feedback, then the students forget about the assignment. They don't care about the feedback because the other tasks are there. And then the meaningful, the feedback must have a meaning. The students must be able to make positive out of it, okay? And then the most important thing which I realized later, when I initially used to give a feedback, I used to write, well, you need to improve this, you need to correct this, and so on. But later on, I realized that there are better ways of writing the feedback if you read the literature, okay? And this is where the word respectful comes, okay? You still give the same feedback, but then that looks very nice for a student to read it and then receive it. So what worked well and what requires improvement is the ultimate aim of the feedback, okay? I give you an example of my feedback here, okay? So this is about the lab reports. In the lab reports, when the students do write, the most important part is the discussion and conclusion. It's very challenging as well, okay? So, and this is where we need to concentrate more, and that's how I give you that. Look at, if you could do this, then the discussion part will improve. You could do this calculation, and here as well in the conclusion is all about like synthesis of main points, not what you are writing, like the experiment worked well, and we learned quite a lot, and so on. Yeah. Okay. The feedback I use is the two-tier approach, actually. Right? The first one is the individual feedback here, as we all do. We give the feedback which is constructive, meaningful, timely, and respectful. Then the students build upon that. The another little thing I use is the feedback to the entire class. So if I give them the test one, then I compare their test one performance of 1 year with the couple of past years. And this is where I explain, guys, as a whole class, how you have performed. Okay? And then I try to find the ways to motivate them to perform to a good level. For example, if you see that the test one here, the average was 21.6 out of 40, and then the 2018 average was 17.8, and then the 17 was 21.8, and this is the point I picked up, guys. Your brothers or sisters of the previous batch have done better than you, and why, how they did better, and so on, and encourage them, motivate them, and you can see the little bit improvement, though the test to performance is always better than that. But if you do something positive in the class, it might have some positive effect. Thank you. So here are 2 points before I finish. The number one point is how to measure the impact of the feedback. Means, are we really measuring the impact of the feedback? Okay. The impact of the feedback is always not clear to either to the students or to the teacher, that how effectively I'm giving, how effectively the students are receiving. I think this is something, the feedback on feedback, maybe we can look at that, the way in which the USP academic staff are giving the feedback, how important or how effective it is. The next one is that the feedback, it takes time to write a feedback, actually. It is time consuming. In the present workload, are we giving a sufficient time to our staff to write a very good, effective feedback? Thank you for listening. That's all.